Well, it's a joy to be able to be here with you for a second talk. We've been invited to give a series of three talks here. So for those of you who weren't here yesterday, we were looking at the whole question about if we have God at the center of our life, does that mean that we're waving goodbye to pleasure? Today, we're looking at this question, which I think is a very real and a very pressing and present question about if the God is a God of love, then why does he also pass judgment? And tomorrow we're going to be also trying to take another and third question where we're just looking at why is it that Christ seems to frame, and indeed does frame, his claim so exclusively. Now this particular question about why does a loving God judge is actually very important, and in one way is a question that many Christians, non-Christians, wrestle with, often at a very, very deep level. At the heart of the Christian faith is the process of putting your trust in someone, your trust in God. But if God is somehow not trustworthy, if his character is such that we actually have good cause to morally question the kind of being he is, how could we possibly put our trust in him, depend, lean, and our faith in him? So the questions about God's moral character become a very strong, informing part of our overall decision about whether we even think God is worthy of our trust, worthy of our faith in that sense. And in that reason, I actually think there's a huge legitimacy to this question, and I think everyone should wrestle with it. I think it's actually very important. Now, the question comes to us in a variety of ways. I'm going to try and touch on a few very briefly and then just focus in on one. One of the ways this question is particularly raised is to do with a perceived tension between the earliest part of the Bible, the Old Testament, and the newest part of the Bible, the New Testament. And that objection goes something like this. Look, the God of the Old Testament seems to specialize in wrath and vengeance, and the God of the New Testament seems to specialize in love and being nice. You know, almost like God has some kind of PR makeover sort of between those two. You know, when we call together a few key spiritual advisors and said, look, this whole wrath thing isn't working for me, this emphasis on judgment, I don't think it's playing too well, and someone said, well, love, that's the way to go. And in the 1960s, the Beatles would come along and write songs about that, and become very, very popular, so why don't you angle it that way? Now, that perceived tension, that the God of the Old Testament is, you read simply about God's judgment, and the God of the New Testament is one where you simply read about God's love, that tension can be overcome by the complex academic discipline known as reading. If you were to read both, you will find that you will read about God's both of these things in both parts. So on your chair in front of you, you have a copy of John's Gospel. And even if you look at the bottom or page 28, as it's given in this booklet, right at the last few lines, you will see that Jesus refers to the fact that he does pass judgment and that his judgment is just because he's not simply here on his own, but because of him who sent him. And if you read this and you take this away, you'll find that Jesus repeats that phrase a bit later on in the Gospel of John, when, again in the context of his judgment, where he talks about, you know, my Father is with me from heaven, my heavenly Father, God. And he is the one who helps testify to my testimony, which is why you can trust both what he says and his judgment. So do take this away and read it. And as a matter of fact, you'll notice on those white feedback forms, if you would like to read this with a member of the Christian Union here at Oxford University so you can ask your questions as you read it through, there is that option, and I'll encourage you to do it. Even if you don't believe it, take some time to find out what it is you're sure you don't believe in. So this tension between the two isn't correct. Now, when you get into the Old Testament, it's very interesting. The books, as we have, if you have a Bible at home, the books of what are called the Old Testament are not necessarily put together in chronological order, they're grouped, gathered together in groups, and there's a little bit of academic debate about which is the oldest book of the Old Testament. But one of the books of the Old Testament, which is considered to be amongst the oldest part of the Old Testament, is a story called Jonah. Now, you may be familiar with this story, you may not be, but Jonah's the story of a guy who was told to go to a group of people he didn't like and tell them they needed to turn away, they needed to repent from the evil things they were doing and turn to God. God didn't want to go. Jonah didn't want to go. He ran away from God. He ran away from this. He went in the opposite direction to which God had asked him to go. He gets swallowed by a giant fish and vomited up onto a beach. This is the part that many modern people is a little bit fishy about the story. And after this very dramatic experience, Jonah decides he will go and he will present this message. And Jonah tells these people that they need to repent. They need to turn away from the evil they've done and they need to turn to God. And everybody does do this, and God forgives them. And after they've been forgiven, this is what happens. It says, but to Jonah this seemed very wrong. Now, and he became angry. Now, I love English translations. Having raised most of my life in the Middle East, we use the language having force. The English language is very often designed to sort of minimize force. Does that make sense? You know, that's interesting. I.e., you're completely off the ball and you're deranged. You know, we use language normally to downplay things. It doesn't capture the full force of how we feel. When it says that Jonah here became angry, it means he was so angry. He was angry to the pit of his stomach. He could have been physically sick with the kind of anger he felt in response to what had happened. That's how angry he was. But to Jonah, this seemed wrong. He became angry. He prayed, isn't this what I said when I was still at home, that I tried to forestall my fleeing to Tarshish? I knew that you are a gracious and compassionate God, slow to anger and abounding in love, a God who relents from sending calamity. Now, O Lord, take away my life. It is better for me to die than to live. So do you see Jonah's complaints about the God of the Old Testament? Jonah's complaint about the God of the Old Testament is he is too kind, too gracious, and too compassionate. He loves forgiving people. So this simple characterization between God's portrayed one way in the Old Testament and this totally different opposing way in the New, as I say, that requires some reading. But there's another thing which goes on here too, because often when we talk about justice, we very often confuse that in our minds with revenge. Now, when you're watching a movie, I don't know what you, if you ever sort of keep track of your own emotions when you're going on a movie or reflect how you think back, but just think of a film in which there was something very, very bad. Now, when you're watching a movie, what do you want to happen to a bad guy at the end of the film? Do you want him caught, put on trial, and sent to jail? Is that what you want? Be honest. What do you want to happen to the evil guy at the end of a movie?
Die.
Thank you. Now, how do you want them to die? Peacefully in their sleep or accidentally run over by a bus they didn't see coming? No. You want them to die slowly, painfully, and to know that death is coming. They have to be aware of it. I can remember watching first showings of GoldenEye in this country, the James Bond movie GoldenEye, when it came out. Any of you watch James Bond movies? Don't be ashamed. Put up your hand if you watch this film. Shame on you. You're wasting your time watching that version. I only watch movies like that for reasons of social research and analysis. But I can remember being in the cinema and we're watching the end of that movie. If you can't remember how it ends, James Bond is fighting the bad guy. And what's happened is a lake is drained. It reveals this giant concrete basin. And suspended over the middle of the basin with large metal wires is a big metal needle, giant metal needle, that's controlling the satellite in outer space. And the fight happens on that metal needle. And it looks like Bond is going to die, but of course he doesn't. And then there's a great reversal. Now Bond is safe, and it looks like the bad guy might die. And James Bond is debating, should he offer his hand to rescue the bad guy from certain death? Because he's an English gentleman, so surely that's what he should do, right? And then, of course, the bad guy starts falling. And as he starts falling, 250 feet, you see him scream as he goes all the way down. Then you can see a camera from the ground looking up. You can see his body rushing up. Then you have the view from the needle, so you can see him disappearing down. Then you have the view from the guy's eyes, as you can see him rushing down to impending doom, so he knows he's going to die, and he knows it's going to be painful, and he hits the concrete surface. Now, I'm not being medically trained, but I'm fairly certain if you fall more than 250 feet and you land on the back of your head, you're dead. Is he dead? No. He opens his eyes just in time to see a massive explosion directly above his head, which releases the large metal needle that has been suspended by the metal rope directly above him. Now you see the needle coming down. You have the wide angle view. You can hear the guy screaming as he sees the needle coming down. Then you have a view from the needle coming down, very close to the guy's mouth. Then you have the view up from his eyes, back up into the thing. Then you have the wide angle thing. You can hear the screaming all the way through. And then the needle comes through, goes through his mouth, and skewers him into the ground. And everyone in the cinema I was in at that point, everyone stood up and started to applaud. You know, we very often talk about justice and cries for justice in our culture, but very often what we're looking for is revenge. And we mustn't get those two things confused. There is a very big difference between the implication of justice and the pursuit of some kind of revenge. Now, to get into the heart, though, of this complaint, of this question, there is a very strong tension which we're going to have to deal with. If God is loving, kind, merciful, how can there be this side to him that does definitely talk about judgment and his anger against sin? So how can we possibly understand that? Now, before jumping in at the whole judgment side, I want to take a few moments just to think about the love side first, because that's the bit we often skip over. I don't know if any of you have seen the 6-part BBC adaptation of Pride and Prejudice, written by Jane Austen, or maybe read the book. If you haven't seen it, you're probably single and probably male. Now, if you have seen it, or you've read the book, you will be aware that Jane Austen's Pride and Prejudice is one of the most endearing love stories written in the English language. It's been popular for a very, very long period of time, and it's grabbed many people's hearts and attention. And at the centre of this novel, you have a brilliant, young, a slightly proud heroine by the name of Elizabeth, and you then also have this rather proud, arrogant, tall guy called Darcy. If you've seen the BBC adaptation, you may notice the passing resemblance between Mr. Darcy and myself. Now, there comes a scene in the novel, which is actually very faithfully portrayed in the BBC adaptation, where Darcy calls on Elizabeth's home to pay a visit, and he is shown into the main living room, and there he finds Elizabeth unaccompanied and alone. And he immediately apologizes, because as an English gentleman, he cannot be alone in a room with a woman to whom he is not betrothed without a chaperone. And I would like to say that as a father of two daughters, I think this is absolutely the right thing to do. So he then apologizes, and he said, "I had no idea you were unaccompanied, otherwise I would not have called." And he bows in apology, and he turns around and he starts walking out the room, and he's halfway out the door when he stops. And then he turns back around, he walks into the room, he looks at her in the eyes and he says, "It will not do. My feelings will not be repressed. You must allow me to tell you how much I ardently admire and love you." Now, please listen carefully. That line is a winner. However, he goes on to say that he loves her, even though it goes against his will, against his reason, and against his own better character. She refuses this declaration of love, and being a man, he can't understand why. So he asks for an explanation. And she looks at him and says, "You told me that you loved me, even though it went against your will, against your reason, against your own better character." In other words, she is saying, "You told me that you loved me, even though it went against all better judgment." You see, true love doesn't exist in the absence of judgment. True love exists in the presence of it. Yesterday, we were talking about our search for intimacy. Most of us are so desperate to be loved and liked by other people. We go around projecting an image of ourselves to other people, hoping that they will accept us. The trouble with that is that people fall in love with the image and not with the reality. That's why it's possible to be very famous, very rich, very beautiful, and yet terribly lonely. Because people only have access to the image and the persona that surrounds you. They never get to know the real you. And regardless of how popular you are or how many people claim to be your friends, you can feel all alone. However, if there are a few people in this world who know the real you, they know all of your shortcomings, all of your weaknesses, all of your failings. If there are any people in the world like that who know you in that way, those are your closest friends. And when anything bad happens, but even more interestingly, when anything good happens in your life, they are the very first people want to speak to. True love doesn't exist in the absence of judgment. True love exists in the presence of it. The words "I love you" are meaningful when the person who speaks them knows the real you. That is precisely the way in which God loves us. He sees us exactly as we are. Do you know that kind of love in your life? This is what it means to be loved by someone. Someone who sees the dark side to who you are, all of your failings, all of your shortcomings, yet they value you and treasure you. Those are the most meaningful relationships you have. There is a very fascinating treatise, I forgot to bring it up here with me, I'll need to actually quote from their work, of great, profound, and philosophical significance. And I can remember the first time I came across this piece of philosophy, I was struck by it, and I've been struck by it ever since. They wrote a very famous and well-known treatise on the nature and subject of love. It was actually written by a group of philosophers called the Black Eyed Peas. You may be familiar. they wrote, it became a number one hit, and it was entitled, strangely enough, Where is the Love? And you see, I thought I brought it up here with me, but maybe for some reason I've forgotten it. Now, as they talk about their song, Where is the Love? They talk about the fact, that we're all searching for something. There's something going wrong in this world. People seem to be getting further away from us. There seems to be more animosity. There seems to be more hatred. But we're crying out, where is the love? But there's a line which hit me between the line, my eyes, between my ears, I should probably say, the first time I heard it, where they say this: the truth is kept secret. It's swept under a rug. If you've never known truth, then you've never known love. The truth is kept secret. It's swept under a rug. If you've never known truth, then you've never known love. They're absolutely correct. We're looking for a love that endures in the face and in the presence of judgment. That's exactly how God loves us. So we have to understand something about the nature of love if we're going to get to the heart of this question. But there's an even deeper part to this that we haven't even yet touched on, which probably explains whether there is some legitimacy in Jonah's anger. Jonah is also angry because he feels he has just witnessed a grave miscarriage of justice. You see, in the story of Jonah, the people who are forgiven have done terrible things, and Jonah hates them. They are his enemies because of the things they have done. And now he is watching people who have done terrible things, his own personal enemies, being forgiven for what they have done, And Jonah is crying out, how is that fair? Where is the justice in this? And there is a sense into which we all also can identify with that. If any of you have ever experienced some kind of injustice in your life, which has not been put right, which has not been addressed, and somehow the guilty one just seems to simply get away with it, we cry out and we say, how is that right? How is that fair? There is this huge longing in our hearts to see justice executed. And when justice collapses in a nation, hope collapses with it. I'll be in a country in a couple of weeks' time where justice and the execution of justice in that country has collapsed, and despair is the daily reality for most of the people who were there. We look for justice in this world, and when things aren't put right, we feel something has gone wrong. So there is an aspect to the anger that Jonah feels that we probably can also identify with. How is this fair? Now this then raises then this very interesting question, because what we are beginning to see is a tension between the execution of justice and the extension of mercy. Now by definition, mercy is extended when we have done something wrong, we're guilty of it, but somehow we don't still have to bear the consequences of it. We're let off, we're forgiven. That's mercy. You don't need mercy if you're not guilty, you haven't done anything wrong. So mercy is a quality that exists in the context of you have done something wrong, and there should be something that happens, but it doesn't happen. You're forgiven, you're let go, you're released. That's mercy. But what that means, therefore, is our mercy is continually exercised at the expense of our justice. Justice is saying we should do one thing, and mercy is saying that we should do something else. And you see this tension in every system of thought in the world, including every religious system of thought in the world. How is it possible to be merciful and uphold justice? And the way that this is reconciled in the Christian faith is by the fact that through the Christian message, through the Christian good news, mercy from God is not extended to us at the expense of God's justice. Mercy from God is extended to us through his justice. It is through the justice of the cross where God himself steps into this world and makes himself one with us. At that point, we say yes to him. And unites himself with us so that our debts become his debts, so that what we have done wrong is his. He goes to the cross and he pays the price for what we have done. And as a result of fulfilling these requirements by him paying for us, when God extends mercy to us, it's not at the expense of saying justice doesn't matter. Justice does matter. There was a price to be paid. It had to be upheld. And it has happened. It is executed. And as a result of fulfilling the requirements of that, God extends his mercy to us through his justice, but not at the expense of it. Now this is an incredible thing. It is the mystery, if you like, which is right at the very center of the Christian faith. It is what it makes it possible to stand before God with peace. I don't know if you've ever done something bad to a friend, and you know you need to make things right. So you confess to them. But you only tell them 80%. Have you ever done this? I mean, 100% would just be too bad. If they knew everything, that's probably the end of the friendship. So what you do is you tell them just enough so that they know that you feel bad about it and they can see you're suffering for it, and then they'll forgive you. But it makes for a very uneasy peace, doesn't it? Because there's that 20% which, if it ever came to light, could be fatal to the relationship. The peace that God wins with us through the justice and judgment of his cross is not an uneasy peace. God sees everything. He knows everything. Jonah's complaint about God was that he was too gracious and too compassionate. Now, the English word compassion, as it's come to us with the ecclesiastical Latin that used to govern the life of the church, is a very interesting compound word. Compassion exists when we make a moral judgment about a situation and are moved in the depth of our being to do something about it. So we have compassion in the face of poverty when we make an absolute moral judgment. That is wrong. And then we are moved in the depth of our being to do something about it. If we're not moved to do anything about it, we don't have compassion, we have moralizing. You have compassion in the face of racism when you make an absolute moral judgment in your heart. That is wrong. And then you are moved in your being to do something about it. If you're not moved in your being to do something about it, you don't have compassion, you just have moralizing again. God looks into every human heart and he passes an absolute moral judgment on the darkness that he sees and says, that is wrong. And then he is moved in the depth of his being to do something about it, and that is the cross. God himself steps into this world. He is willing to make himself one with us so that our failings become his. What we have done wrong becomes his. He pays for it on the cross, and through his resurrection, he offers us new life and forgiveness through him. Do you know that kind of forgiveness in your life? If you're sat here today and you think that being a Christian means believing in a certain idea, or even believing in right ideas, you may not have understood what it means to truly be a Christian. A Christian is someone who looks on God's provision and possibility for forgiveness on the cross and says, may that be for me. I need you to pay for me, and I would love to have that forgiveness. And the result is joy. We're going to have a time to ask a few questions in a moment. But before I do so, I'm going to ask you just very briefly to have a look at this feedback card, which you'll notice on one side is blank. We would invite everybody here, regardless of where you come from, to give some feedback on today's event and what you've heard so far. You're all very welcome to do that. Now, if you flip it over, you'll see there are a series of boxes. One of them at the bottom says, I have a question or a comment. And if you would like to ask a question and make a know for sure that someone's going to come back to you and answer it, if you tick that box and write down your question, give your name and how you can be contacted and so on, someone will meet with you within 24 hours to talk about it. If you tick, I want to hear about future events, in the week after this week, there's something called the search, which is happening, certainly on a Monday, possibly also on a Tuesday, but certainly on Monday, which will allow you to look into the Christian faith in detail and try to figure out what it is really saying. Is it genuinely true? What difference does it make? And if you have never considered this for yourself, why not try going along, signing up for that, and just seeing how it goes? Now, the one above that says, I'd like to read Uncover John with someone. You can take this Gospel of John away with you, and you can read it for yourself. But if you would like to read it with another student from the university, so you can talk with them about what you're reading, ask your questions, what does this mean, how should I understand that? If you fill out that card and put it in that box, then someone will meet up with you at a time convenient to you, and you can read and discuss this together. Now, the top box says, count me in. faith is true. You are sure both about the identity of Christ, that he's the Son of God, about why he came, that he did come to save and rescue and forgive by laying down his life on the cross. And you know you need to say yes to him. You need that forgiveness in your life for what you have done wrong, and you're willing to say sorry and turn away from it. If that's where you are right now, I'd invite you just to take 15 seconds to pray a very short prayer with me, which basically says, God, I am sorry for what I have done, but I thank you for you, that you stepped into this world as the person of Christ. You've made forgiveness possible through the cross, and I want you both at the center of my life, and I'll follow you, whatever it is. If you know that's where you are, you need to say yes to him today, then I'd invite you just to pray this with me, and then fill out this card to count me in. And however you fill out this feedback form, as you leave, just put it in the basket, and then someone will be in contact with you about how we can follow you up. But let me just give you that moment just to think. What is your response today? No, I don't believe it. Well, please ask questions now. Hang around, ask questions afterwards. We'll stay here as long as we need to answer whatever questions there may be. If it's I'm not sure, why not take the time to look into it? Is it true? If the answer is yes, then I'll invite you just to talk with God and say, I'm sorry for what I've done, and I need that forgiveness. I'm going to offer that prayer now. Now, you may like to close your eyes if you want to. You don't have to. If you do close your eyes, you may want to put your hand on your purse or your wallet or your coat. We live in a depraved, wicked generation. We have no idea who is that next to you. And although following Christ may be costly, I don't want it to start with you losing your purse. If you are in that stage, then why not just pray this with me? God, I know you see everything, and I'm sorry for what I have done wrong. I thank you for the provision that you have made. I thank you came into this world in the person of Christ. I want to be one with you. I know that you have paid for things I have done wrong, and I thank you about justice. And I thank you even more that you've made mercy and forgiveness possible. I'm sorry for what I've done. May I know that forgiveness in my life. And may I follow you, however much it may cost me. Amen.
So if we can have maybe the first question on the screen.
Someone once said, if you really want to know what people are thinking about, then you shouldn't listen to what politicians are saying, you should listen to what people of songs are actually singing. Because very often you find more honesty expressed in the heart cry that you hear in our music than you actually do through both the politicians and the philosophers. But for some reason, even though I was convinced it was here, but otherwise I would love to have sung it for you, and I'm very disappointed not to have been quoted to you all of the lyrics. I'm tempted to try and do it by memory, but I think I'll be stuck halfway through. Sadly, I'm kind of disappointed on that one.
Next question. What kind of perverse leads God to subject Jesus to enormous undeserved suffering?
That is a very good question. And I would love to have addressed that in the main subject of my talk, had there been a bit more time, so why don't we take a few moments to do it now. I think the first thing to say is that Jesus Christ is not some kind of unwilling victim in this story. The story isn't that God decided to pick on someone who had absolutely no interest in what was going on and say, right, you are going to pay for everyone else. That's not what happened. Jesus Christ said, for this very purpose I have come into this world, and for this very hour I have come. It's something that he willingly and deliberately gave himself over to. And that this is something that he wanted and wished to do. He was willing to lay down his life for us. So that's the first thing. The second thing to do is to say that he's not some kind of unrelated third party. When I said to him, he has no connection. At that point of saying yes to Christ, we become one with him. The way some great historical theologians have put it, they said that, now we're changing this at the moment because we now have what are called prenuptial agreements if you get married. But classically, at that point of marriage, The deaths of one became the deaths of both. You were one in the eyes of the Lord. And when we become one with Christ, what we have done wrong, our sin becomes his, imputed to him, and his righteousness, his goodness, is given over to us. Which is why you also have this very powerful biblical image of Jesus, of the sight of Jesus taking off from us some kind of stained outer garment and clothing us in his goodness. Notice that he makes us right because of that. So there's also that. Now there's another aspect, however, which is very important. And we do wrestle with it in our culture. And we wrestled with it for a while, at least for the last 40, 50 years. Professor C.S. Lewis, who used to be a teacher, picked up on this many decades ago, when he said, look, there are three elements when we come to the justice system, when we think about how people should be punished for what they've done. So the first one is rehabilitation. When we punish someone for something they've done wrong, we want to make them better. In a sense, change their behavior. The other one is deterrence. We want to deter other people from doing similar things. And the third one is retribution. They should pay for what they have done. Now, that third element, that idea of retribution in our criminal justice system, is something which has become increasingly unpopular with every passing year. But here's the issue. Please try and follow this with me. Although I have no problem with rehabilitation and with the terrorists, so that is the only reason why I think this is a massive problem. I'll try to explain why. The City Council have recently imposed sort of 20-mile-an-hour speed limits in parts of town, you know, around Oxford. So let's suppose the City Council was to sit down one day and they figure out that students in particular are violating the 20-mile-an-hour speed limit because they're always late for lectures and students shouldn't have cars anymore. The students who should be thoroughly discouraged in order to deal with both the pollution and congestion problems in the city. So they come up with a new plan. What they do is that they stop cars moving more than 20 miles an hour, and on finding that you are indeed not a university student, they ask you to put your hand out of the window, at which point the police will close your hand off. Now, here's the question. Would that change your pattern of behavior? Would it rehabilitate what you did? Are you likely to speed again? I'd like to suggest to you the answer to that question is yes, you probably are likely to change your pattern of behavior. Is it fair? Is it just? Is it equitable? Let's supposing they think, well, what we need to do is we need to deter others. They ask you your name and your address, and they ask who your 10 closest friends at the university are. And then the next day, as you're driving through town, there are 10 gallows, and your friends are all hanging from the gallows by their neck with a sign around their body saying, and anyone else who caught this speeding, this is what we'll do to your friends as well. Now, is this likely to have a deterrent effect in society? Some of you look uncertain. Can you suggest the answer is yes, absolutely. It will deter. Is it fair? Is it just? No. We ask of a deterrence, not whether it is just, but whether it successfully deters. We ask of a rehabilitation, not whether it is just, but whether it successfully rehabilitates. What Lewis said is, by this is our only theory of justice. We have moved people out of the sphere of justice altogether, and some of the most tyrannical and abusive regimes in political history are those who have used their justice system purely as means of deterrence and rehabilitation without any thought to the nature of retribution, what might actually be deserved by the crime which has been committed. We need all three of those present in our system. And what Christ does, he comes into this world. And the question is, well, how should God feel about the injustices that happen in this world? We like to celebrate in the West that slavery was abolished, but the simple truth is that men and women are being bought and sold in this country and in Western Europe as sex slaves almost every single day. And one of the first national cases exposing this actually happened right here in Oxford. A few years ago, some of you may not have been here. Well, what's the appropriate response to that? Well, that's a shame. Never mind. What is the appropriate response? The God of the Bible, both in terms of his level of his emotional response, his anger towards sin, and in terms of the penalty, the price that should be paid for what we've done wrong, is entirely, I think, correct. thing is that Christ willingly comes into this world and says, I'm willing to pay for what we collectively have done. This is why becoming a Christian is an inherently humbling thing. I know there are many Christians out there who are portrayed as being proud, sometimes unfairly. Sadly, sometimes Christians are portrayed as being proud and arrogant because that's the way they conduct themselves. But there is no room for pride or arrogance in the Christian faith. It is inherently humbling. It forces all of us to examine where we ourselves have gone wrong, where we have failed, and understand the enormity that God is willing to go to in order to rescue us out of the situation we find ourselves in. This is a very imperfect analogy, but for those of you who were here yesterday, we were talking about love, how love might be one with God. But let's suppose you walk out of this room and you think, I really don't like Michael Ramsden, I hate everything about him. You wouldn't be the first, but. And then let's suppose in that night you're talking to your parents or guardians or, I don't know, someone much older than you who's a close friend, and they say, what did you do today? So, well, I wasted lunchtime by listening to this guy called Michael Ramsden speak. And then they go, oh, quite tall guy.
Yeah.
Sort of slightly Middle Eastern looking.
Yeah.
Attractive. And eventually you figure out, it is me. And then they say, you know, there's something about Michael you don't know. When you were 5 years old, you were dying from a rare kidney condition. And you were desperately in a transplant. And he happened to be visiting the town we lived in at the time. And he offered himself up for a genetic test, and he was a perfect match for you. And he gave up one of his kidneys for you. Now, does that fact change the way you feel about me? And the answer is probably yes. You'll probably at least swing from thinking, I never want to see that guy again, to, I'm wondering if I get his email and write to him and just say, thank you very much. I had no idea you ever did this for me. I've only just found out. I want to say thank you. The chances are it would affect how you felt about me. God has done much more for us than just simply give us a kidney. He's given us himself, so that we did it, but he did it willingly. But the nature of your question is very well put, and actually it really deserves a 1 hour talk just to answer that. So I'm more than happy to talk to you some more if you'd like to, at the end of it, because it's a very fair and good one.
What about hell as a result of judgment? The idea of eternal suffering for people who may not realize it is true and would not choose hell does not seem fair.
I think that's a very good question as well. Who would like to answer? Okay, let's just say two things. If you were there last night, I think you would have had a passage read to you from John chapter 3, which says something like this. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. And whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already, because they have not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. Now, this is a very difficult and very controversial thing, and he's saying two things. Number one, Jesus says actually the reason that people may will miss out on salvation is because they said no to him. The mental picture we often have when we think of it, I think especially of a question like this, goes something like this. Look, I didn't choose to be born, I didn't choose to come into this world. And according to you Christians, I was born into a fallen world filled with sin. So I'm born into this world full of sin, and I'm drowning in it, and I can't swim. And then after I drown in it, God comes and punishes me for drowning. So how's that fair? Now, if that's the nature of the complaint, it has a lot of force. But let's just change that a little bit. Let's suppose you're drowning in the sea of sin. God comes along, holds out his hand, and says, take my hand, I'd like to take you out. And you say, no, thank you, if I get out, I'd like to get out on my own. And then you say, and God says, no, don't be stupid, you can't sin, swim. You stay here, you will drown. Put your hand in mine, and I'll lift you out. And the response is, if I get out, I'll get out on my own. And then you drown. Does that change the nature of the picture? In Christ, God extends the hand of salvation now to all of humanity and says, you can't get out of this mess yourself, and I'm not even blaming you for all of it. But if you don't take and believe in the only way out of this and rescue from this promise, for that you will be held accountable, Jesus says. And I agree this is a very hard and difficult thing. Now there's a second thing which is equally controversial. And I'll give this to you as a hypothetical. But in another part part of the Bible, in the book called Romans, chapter 1, God claims that it's possible to know that he exists and that that will be made apparent to everybody. Now, I know you may disagree with that statement, but this is supposing if that were true. If it were the case that everyone on the final day of judgment would be without excuse, in other words, no one will be able to say, hey, this wasn't fair, I didn't know, does that change the question? And while you think about my question back to your very good and difficult question, we'll have to end it there because it's coming up at 2 o'clock and some of you have to go for lectures. Thank you for coming to listen. If you want to come and challenge me, speak to me some more, I'll be down here. Come and ask if you want a guest or one of those who come here today specifically to answer questions as a Christian. I'd like you just to stand up. You're sat at the moment. There are various guests and various other people here. We've got some people who are studying with us this year too. So anyone you see standing here, if you've got a question and you remain unpersuaded, go and speak to them and they will do their utmost and their best to answer you. You may prefer to speak to them rather than come to me. Otherwise, I'm happy to stay here as long as I can to answer any questions you may have. Thank you for being so gracious and giving me a hearing. I hope I get to see some of you again tomorrow for the Bible in this series together. Please do come this evening if you weren't there last night.